Hello, my name is Emily Tingus, and I'm a St. Tammany Parish Public School biology teacher. I'm so glad you could join me. In this lesson, we're going to go on a nature walk together. My students recently finished a study of ecology, and this outdoor study is a great way to demonstrate and view all of those ecology concepts. We're going to begin in my backyard and make our way through the wooded area behind it. As you can see, we've sort of created a forced food chain here with our bird feeder. I bought bird seed, which comes from our autotrophs or producers, and put it out for the birds or primary consumers to eat. I usually see and hear different populations of birds around the feeder. Remember, a population is organisms of the same species. One of my favorite is the red cardinal. Typically, I see a bright, beautiful red male flanked by two or three lighter colored females. The male is brightly colored to attract the females. Another important ecological factor out here is competition between the birds and squirrels, which are also primary consumers of the seeds. I put this cone on the feeder as a squirrel deterrent, but they still somehow jump and climb to get the bird seed. Kudos to the squirrels though. Survival of the fittest out here, and they're able to make it. Let's move into the wooded area now. So here's just a little bit more of the wildlife around. There's a squirrel. He actually just jumped off of the bird feeder. And then if we look way in the back, that little brown blob, that was a bunny. These woods are the habitat for many organisms that have unfortunately lost their habitat due to home construction in the area. For this reason, we sometimes have species coming into their unnatural habitat like a lizard in the garage or a spider in the house. You should be able to see here lots of plants or producers in this habitat. Their niche or role is to provide multiple aspects to their habitat. They're the bottom of the food chain or the first trophic level. They convert energy from the sun into usable energy and food for themselves, which ultimately becomes food for the other trophic levels. They are also key players in the carbon cycle, as the plants take carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and give it to living things when consumed. Virtually all of the molecules in our body contain carbon, so plants are incredibly important. Plants also produce oxygen through photosynthesis, which we need to survive. When we inhale the oxygen and go through cellular respiration or breathing, we put more carbon dioxide into the atmosphere for the plants. This is sort of a symbiotic relationship of mutualism between plants and animals. All right, everybody, so I'm here kind of in the middle of a clearing. This is obviously a four-wheeler track. Makes a little circle in this clearing. And what I've actually found here in this sort of muddy area is some deer tracks. So there's one, and then if we keep going, that right there, kind of resembles possibly some armadillo tracks. But if we keep going, looks like, just stuck in the mud, it looks like another set of tracks there, and then a pretty perfect set right there as well. And it looks like they just kind of keep going through here. There is a pond that is nearby that the deer can go to. Let's continue on our path into more of the wooded area. We cleared this path so that we could make it back to the pond in our neighborhood, but it's a little bit smaller than the large open four-wheeler area that we just went through. All right, everybody, just taking a walk through and happen to glance down and see evidence of another primary consumer or herbivore. These are rabbit droppings, and that obviously tells me that little bunnies have been around here. They'll eat through the grass, they'll eat through smaller plants, and they primarily consume plants. Those rabbits will then become the food source or energy source for secondary consumers, which we've seen sometimes hawks or coyotes will eat the rabbits. Those secondary consumers would be carnivores in that instance, but they can also be omnivores, eating both plants and animals. Now, humans are typically omnivores and they eat a variety of foods from a variety of sources. Humans are also the apex predator, or the top of the food chain. We may not be the biggest organism, but we certainly have the biggest brain and are able to outsmart our prey and our would-be predators. However, survival of the fittest applies to humans too. All right, everybody, continuing on our path, I wanted to point out another type of symbiotic relationship. This white covering on this tree, this is called lichen. Now, lichen is a mutualistic relationship between bacteria and fungus. You see, the fungus lacks chlorophyll, so it can't produce its own food, but the algae that lives with it, the other part of that mutualistic relationship, that algae produces carbon, and that is what the fungus needs. And so they live together on the tree in this mutualistic symbiotic relationship. I've just been walking through the woods, listening to the birds calling, saying they're awake. Baby birds may be saying that they're hungry. I saw some blue jays earlier fighting with each other. They were quite noisy, but they moved on. It appeared that two males were fighting over a female. Okay, here we've made it over to a smaller pond in our neighborhood. As you can see here, I don't know if you can see it just yet, but we clearly have some plants that are thriving in this water area in this ecosystem. This also provides a nice little walk down for the deer to get to that water source. Okay, so just down here, right outside of this smaller pond, I'm not sure if you can see it, but if you look just between those two trees right there, that sort of hazy area, and there's a little fly flying around it, or maybe a gnat. That is a spider web. There's one just past it that's a little bit smaller. The spider has taken advantage of this great location near the water, and it's spun its web here. There are typically a lot of insects that will lay their larvae and lay their eggs near the water, and so the spider has a great chance of catching lots of insects in its web if it's near the water. So I just happened to catch that, thought it was pretty cool. I don't see it, but I can hear it. I can hear a frog croaking. I'm gonna be quiet and see if y'all can listen. Okay, there it was. It's obviously home here to frogs. I know we've also seen turtles in this area of the pond as well. I'm still near the pond area, everybody. Trying not to get too close and trying not to be too loud. I don't want to disturb their habitat. I also don't want to scare them away so that we can see them. But I'm going to walk on and see if I can find anything else. There's definitely a crow coming through. There it goes. All right, let's carry on. All right, everybody, we're coming to the end of our nature walk. I've walked through more spider webs than I care to, but enjoyed nature nonetheless. Hearing all the birds has been a nice way to wake up this morning. We're actually going to finish our nature walk near our neighborhood pond. Well, the second pond. Here it is over here. We're just going to cross over this little ditch and all the poison ivy and make our way to the pond. Neighbors will often come here and fish, do a little catch and release. We've caught catfish out here. And we've actually been working with LSU to create better habitat for the fish. Now this pond actually forms as a drainage pond for the neighborhood. and it does connect out to the Chifuncta River. There is a natural drainage canal just kind of on the other side of that fountain. And so sometimes, usually in the spring, usually around this time, we'll typically find a baby alligator that has made its way over to say hello. But in this pond, like I said before, we have fish that live here. We also have some turtles that have taken up residency in the pond as well. I hope you've enjoyed the nature walk, and I hope you've learned a little bit about ecology. And I hope to see you all soon.
Hey everybody, Mr. Mac here with your short mini lesson on the election of 1912. So it's really, really rare that I look at an election and say, man, that election is so important that I need to do a specific lesson on it. But this one really is. So one of the reasons why it's so important is because it's going to have three presidents involved. Theodore Roosevelt, who had been president, William Howard Taft, who was currently president, and then Woodrow Wilson, who would become president. Let's start by giving a short introduction to each one of these guys. Theodore Roosevelt, you know a ton about him already, but he was president from 1901 to 1909. Theodore Roosevelt became president because he was William McKinley's vice president. William McKinley gets shot in the stomach and dies, and Theodore Roosevelt in 1901 becomes president. Now, Theodore Roosevelt gets elected in his own right, and serves what is really his first term in office from 1905 to 1909. And whenever he gets that term, he makes a statement that he's going to basically regret forever. And he says that he won't run for a second term in office. So Theodore Roosevelt could have been president for a long time, but he chooses not to run for that second term, even though he could have. And he will regret this basically from the second that he says it. So Theodore Roosevelt serves, like I said, 1901 to 1909, and he does a ton of stuff. He's known as a trust buster, right? He gets the Panama Canal, and really just a litany of things that Theodore Roosevelt accomplishes while he is in office. And if this is going to be a mini lesson, I can't get into all of them. But whenever Theodore Roosevelt is preparing to leave the White House, he chooses his Secretary of War, William Howard Taft, to be his replacement. And William Howard Taft will win the Republican nomination for president in 1908, and then eventually will win the election. So a little bit about William Howard Taft. William Howard Taft is famous for a couple of things. One, he weighed 350 pounds. He was a big boy. And the thing that he was most famous for might be a myth. It's getting stuck in a bathtub at the White House. That's the big William Howard Taft story. We don't know if that happened for sure, but we do know for sure that they did have to get new bathtubs in the White House when William Howard Taft moved in because he was so big. The other thing is that William Howard Taft really didn't want to be president. He wanted to be the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, but his wife, William Howard Taft's wife, really wanted him to be president. She was a very pushy, maybe a little bit conniving and ambitious woman, but he also, because Theodore Roosevelt wanted him to do it, people seemed to kind of push him in that direction. He was willing to do it. Now, Taft really never overcomes the idea, the image in the minds of the American people and in the minds of the media that he's just a puppet for Theodore Roosevelt. And, you know, the joke about William Howard Taft while he's president is Taft, take advice from Teddy, which is kind of the truth. But the problem is that Theodore Roosevelt really is not a fan of what William Howard Taft does once he gets into office. He thinks, man, I got this guy this job, and now he's not even doing what I would have done. But the problem is that nobody is Theodore Roosevelt, and nobody does things exactly like Theodore Roosevelt would have done them. So William Howard Taft, again, I could get into a ton of stuff, reasons why specifically. It had to do really with trusts and things like that, among other things. I could get into the specifics of it, but if we're going to keep this short, just know that Theodore Roosevelt really doesn't approve of what William Howard Taft does as president and comes out against him. And this ruins their friendship. And that's a really important thing to remember here. Taft and Roosevelt are essentially best friends. And this is going to really, eventually they'll make up, but it's never the same. Once Roosevelt starts to insult William Howard Taft, and then comes out and competes against Taft, Roosevelt famously says, "My hat is in the ring," and he opposes Taft for the election in 1912 on the Republican side. Now, on the Democrat side, we have Woodrow Wilson. Woodrow Wilson was a former president of Princeton University. He's an academic type of guy. If Theodore Roosevelt is a very practical, get things done type of guy, Woodrow Wilson really is kind of the opposite. He is a, he's very much a guy who comes from academia. He comes from colleges. And that's he has a very professorial type of way about him. He's very, very different from Theodore Roosevelt. And you'll really see this highlighted whenever the First World War breaks out and Woodrow Wilson is president. Because what these guys don't understand is that they're actually competing to be the leader of America when it enters the largest war in human history. And Woodrow Wilson is very much anti-war, where Theodore Roosevelt is very much pro-war. You don't hear a lot of pro-war guys anymore. But Theodore Roosevelt would just straight up tell you, yeah, war is awesome and I like it. Woodrow Wilson is the total opposite. And so the way that we see this, Woodrow Wilson feels like he is essentially someone sent by God. His father was a minister, and Woodrow Wilson sort of sees himself as a minister in the arena of politics. And whenever the First World War breaks out in 1914, Woodrow Wilson will be president, and when he runs for re-election, he'll be saying, "He kept us out of war." That will be his tagline. He kept us out of war. Now, in 1917, eventually Wilson will get reelected in 1916, but in 1917, Wilson is going to have to enter the war. And when we get into the war, and this is where you see sort of the heart of what Wilson wants, he wants to essentially make war illegal. He wants to create a League of Nations where countries come together and talk out their problems. And it will get created, but America doesn't join. That's a whole nother lesson. But again, Woodrow Wilson, in a lot of ways, is sort of like the peace candidate and the high-minded candidate. And you see that really possibly because he comes from colleges. And Woodrow Wilson is going to get the nomination on the Democrat side. So by hook or by crook, on the Republican side, William Howard Taft gets the Republican nomination. A lot of people feel like, and there is a good bit of evidence to support this, Theodore Roosevelt kind of got gypped out of that nomination. He probably should have been the Republican nominee. And if he had been, he probably would have won. But as it stands, Theodore Roosevelt is not the Republican nominee. William Howard Taft is. Woodrow Wilson's the Democrat nominee, and Taft is on the Republican side. But Theodore Roosevelt is not one to back down from a fight. And he goes and joins the Progressive Party. Now, you remember, this is in the height of the progressive movement, that movement of people trying to make things better for working, really just for normal people, right? You had the muckrakers who were revealing the bad conditions in the meat industry and taking pictures of tenement houses and lobbying for women's right to vote. And Theodore Roosevelt was all in on all of this stuff. So he becomes the presidential candidate for the Progressive Party. But very soon, it becomes known by a much, much better, much better known, and let's be honest, a much, much cooler name, the Bull Moose Party. And the reason why it's called the Bull Moose Party is because Theodore Roosevelt, when asked while he's running for the Republican nomination, they say, a reporter says, "Teddy, how you feeling?" He says, "I'm as healthy as a bull moose." And from then on, he's known as the Bull Moose. And so the Progressive Party gets the nickname the Bull Moose Party. And speaking of the Bull Moose title, this is the election whenever Theodore Roosevelt is campaigning for himself, right, to be the president again in 1912. He is on his way to make a speech, and he's riding in an open-top car because apparently no one has figured out in 1912 that, hey, it would be super, super easy to shoot somebody in an open-top car. As Theodore Roosevelt is making his way through a very crowded street, because people loved Theodore Roosevelt. Everywhere he went, crowds turned out. He's waving to the crowd, and a man walks up and shoots him in the chest. Roosevelt, you know, obviously is taken aback a little bit, but he coughs into his hand and sees that there's no blood, and so he knows that he's not bleeding. Doesn't have blood in his lungs. And he goes and he grabs the man who shot him, and he says, hey, no, why'd you do that? Why did you do that? And when he sees that the man won't answer him, he lets him go. And by the way, the reason why the guy tried to kill him is because he thought that William McKinley's ghost told him to do it. So the guy, you know, probably nuts. But anyways, they want to take Roosevelt straight to the hospital, but Roosevelt says, no, I'm going to make my speech. His glasses case and his 50-page or so manuscript that he had written his speech on slowed the bullet. And so the bullet actually never left his chest. It stayed with him until he died, and it actually slowed him down a lot. But at the time, he still had a speech to make. He goes to his speech, and as he gets there, he says to the crowd, I must ask you all to be very quiet. I don't know if you understand what's happened, but I've just been shot. And someone in the crowd, yells, you know, liar or cheat, or, you know, basically says, you're making that up. And Roosevelt, who was, you know, probably waiting on somebody to say that to him, you know, pulls his jacket off to the side and shows him. And he says, it takes a lot more than that to kill a bull moose. And, you know, I always say if I had been there, I would have just absolutely run through the wall, because I love Theodore Roosevelt as it is. But I mean, this is him at his absolute best. But as the campaign goes on, it only serves to make the torn friendship between Roosevelt and Taft even worse. They did trade insults with each other, and obviously both insult Woodrow Wilson, and this election gets ugly. But I haven't even mentioned a guy named Eugene Debs, who was a well-known socialist at the time. Eugene Debs is going to be in prison at the time that the election takes place, but he has such a large following in the socialist community that Eugene Debs is going to get over 1 million votes for the presidency in 1912. Now, he doesn't win, but that's still a lot of votes for a guy that is in jail. So the election plays itself out, and the problem for Theodore Roosevelt and for William Howard Taft is that they cancel each other out. The progressives, certainly they vote for Roosevelt, but even some Republicans vote for Roosevelt. And Roosevelt actually beats Taft. In the end, Wilson is going to come in first, Roosevelt will come in second, and Taft will come in third. And I mean, that's a big fall for a sitting president. Taft at the time has what you call the power of the incumbency, which means that if you're the sitting president, you really have an advantage over the people that you're running against. But that wasn't the case for Taft, and he never did have the charisma or really even the desire. Remember, this wasn't even a job that Taft wanted to do, but good news for Taft is that in the 1920s, he will actually get appointed as the head of the Supreme Court, and he will get that job. He's the only guy ever to serve as the as a Supreme Court justice and a president. So in the end, Woodrow Wilson is going to win this election. Really, he's going to get a lot of electoral votes. He'll get 435 electoral votes. Theodore Roosevelt will win a respectable, something like six states, and get 88 electoral votes, whereas Taft will only win two states and get eight electoral votes, and the rest of the states went to Woodrow Wilson. So in the end, Woodrow Wilson becomes president and will be the president. The reason why this election is so important, Woodrow Wilson is the president that will lead us into World War I. He'll keep us out of World War I from 1914 to 1917 through the sinking of the Lusitania, right? Even though Germany sinks the Lusitania in 1915 with American passengers on board, Woodrow Wilson still doesn't enter the war, and Theodore Roosevelt almost definitely would have. And he makes fun of Woodrow Wilson mercilessly for not entering the war. At one point, Theodore Roosevelt goes to the White House whenever World War I is about to break out and speaks with Woodrow Wilson. And Theodore Roosevelt says, please let me go and fight in the war. Keep in mind, by this point, Roosevelt's something like 55 years old. And he says, please let me go fight in this war. Please let me go fight in this war. Let me form another division of the Rough Riders. And he says to Wilson, if you let me go and fight in this war, I promise you, I'll never come back. And you won't have me making fun of you and insulting you in the papers. And he was joking, but not that much, right? Well, Roosevelt probably has a pretty good idea that if he goes and fights in the Great War, he's going to die there. Woodrow Wilson says no. And a lot of people think that, one, you can't have Theodore Roosevelt, a former president, one of the most beloved presidents in American history. You can't have him going and dying in World War I. But a lot of people also think that Woodrow Wilson knows if Theodore Roosevelt goes and fights in that war and then comes back, he is going to be so popular that he'll almost definitely, definitely win the election in 1920. But the problem is that Theodore Roosevelt would never make it to that point. Theodore Roosevelt is going to die. He's going to die in 1919. He's going to die in his sleep. And one of his friends will famously say, death had to take Theodore Roosevelt in his sleep, because if he had been awake, there would have been a fight. You know, Theodore Roosevelt, the adrenaline junkie who loved a good fight, in the end dies young and dies at the age of 60. A lot of Roosevelts did. Woodrow Wilson won't make it much longer either. Woodrow Wilson dies, I believe, in 1923. He had a series of strokes. In the last year of Woodrow Wilson's White House, his wife was basically running the show. But by the 1920s, William Howard Taft, that poor guy, will finally achieve his dream of being a Supreme Court justice. The way that I'll end this story, eventually Roosevelt and Taft, they did make up. Their friendship was never the same, but they did make up. At Theodore Roosevelt's funeral, the last person sitting at his grave after everybody had left was William Howard Taft. And he sat and he wept, because he missed his friend so much, and he knew that politics had ruined what they once had in their essentially best friendship. So this was the election of 1912, one of the craziest elections ever in American politics.
Exercises on So I might be able to do 5 of these and say, oh, you know what, that was easy. I need to do 10. Well, that means next time I do my routine, I'll do the cardio for 1 minute, and then I'll go over here and I'll do 10 of all the exercises. By maybe in 2 weeks, if I've been doing this routine over and over, I might find that, you know, hey, 5 is too easy of some of these exercises, so I'm going to go ahead and push myself up to doing 10 of all these exercises. So let me just give you an example. If you're doing 1 minute of cardio here, and you come in and you're doing 5 of all these exercises, and more than half of these exercises are easy at 5, go ahead and jump all the exercises up to 10. In other words, don't do 5 of some of them and do 10 of the others. Try to stay moving up in sequence with all of them. So if 5 is easy on more than half of them, try going up to 10 on all of them. That way you're pushing yourself. That's the idea behind that, to push yourself so that you can become stronger than you were in the beginning of doing these exercises. All right, so the first thing you want to do before you start exercising is warm up. So you want to jog in place for, you know, approximately 1 minute. So you want to start moving around. You can have fun with it. Jog back and front. You can go forward and back. You can go sideways. Just, you know, as long as you're getting that heart rate up, meaning that it's getting a little bit harder to breathe comfortably. It should be getting a little bit harder for me to talk to you while I'm moving. So, I'm so happy to be here with you today. I'm so glad that you're exercising with me. Exercise is the best thing that you can do for your body. All right, we're getting warmed up? I think so. All right, so our first cardio exercise is arms circles with a kick. So we're going to do this for approximately 1 minute. Now, if you don't have a watch that has a timer on it, you can look at a clock, or you can just approximate. This is your workout. This is your time. You have to do what works for you. Now, I'm here just to show these exercises to you. And hopefully you will do them by yourself when you're bored or when you just feel like, you know what, I need to move. Okay, so this is arm circles. You want to keep your arms up at shoulder height. Don't let them drop down. Don't let them come up. Okay, and then you kick up just a slight kick. We're not doing real high kicks right now. This is just, you know, so to get your heart rate moving. All right, that was 1 minute. So we did 1 minute of cardio. Now we have push-ups is our first exercise here. So you can do those on your toes. You can do them on your knees. Some people are going to do them on their toes, and some have to do them on their knees. That is okay. You do these push-ups the way you need to do them. Because this is your exercise routine. So, proper push-up, your hands are right underneath your shoulders. You're going to bring your chest down to the ground. You're going to make sure your whole body is in a line. You don't let your belly sag down, and don't let your butt go up in the air. So you want to try and keep everything in a level straight line. You're looking down your nose, and you're going to bring your chest to the ground. Down and up. Down and up. Now, if that's too hard, drop to your knees. Make sure your butt is still tucked under, and you want to bring your chest to the ground. Down and up. Down and up. If that's still too hard, you can come to all fours, and you just want to make sure that you are bending at the elbows and trying to bring your chest to the ground. Okay? So, this is working your chest. Now, I just showed you a few of them to demonstrate. Some of you might be able to handle doing 10 right away if you've been working out for quite some time now. So that's the push-up. Now we're back to 1 minute of cardio. So I'm going to go ahead and get started and then explain how to do the skaters as I'm moving. Now, I am hopping over on my right foot, bringing the left foot behind it, and then you can reach down to the ground and touch with the opposite hand, or you can just step over like I'm stepping with the left. I'm going to bring the right foot behind me, and you can just go like right outside the knee. So for some people, right here, this is good. Some people need to touch the ground. Okay, this is a skater. This is going to work those legs. It's going to work the quadriceps here. It's going to work the gluteus maximus. And it's going to get your heart rate up. So this exercise is very, very good for getting the heart rate up. Now you don't have to go down and touch the ground. You can just stay here. Touch right outside the knee. But you want to do that for 1 minute. There we go. Now we move on to sit-ups. The next exercise. Remember, if you do five of these and it's too easy, move on to 10. So, sit-ups. Touch your toes. Bring those arms behind your head. Your whole body is straight on the ground. Up, touch the toes. Behind the head. If you find that too hard, just bend the knees and don't come all the way up. And just touch your knees. If that's still too hard, you can just cross your arms over your chest and just do crunches. You're still working those abdominal muscles, which is the tummy muscles. All right, so now we're back to 1 minute of cardio, one that everyone does in PE, jumping jacks. So you can have fun with your jumping jacks. You can go side to side. You can go in a circle. You can go in the opposite direction. So a proper jumping jack, just so I can demonstrate them to you. Feet apart, arms up, feet together, arms down. So you just put that in fast motion. You have the feet going in and out while the arms are going up and down. Now if you get tired, you can do them here. You can bring one leg out while the other arm goes up. This is your routine, do what works for you. But if you can stay here with jumping jacks for 1 minute, you go around in a circle, and then go in the opposite direction, woohoo! You just have fun for you. Make this your exercise routine. Okay? We got to be there. That was 1 minute. Perfect. Now, burpees. So, I think I've demonstrated these before if you watched my last video, but I'm going to demonstrate them again. You are going to squat down. You're going to put your hands down on the ground. Bring your legs out behind you. Put your chest on the ground. You're going to push yourself up. Bring your legs back in underneath you. And then jump up as high as you can. Try to touch the ceiling. Okay. So in fast motion, squat down, legs out, chest to the ground, push yourself up, legs back in, hop up. If that's too hard, you can do an exercise called a thruster, where you squat down, push your legs out behind you, push your legs back in underneath you, and jump up. So remember, you have to do your level of this exercise, and as you progress, which means as you do this exercise routine, you can make it harder for the next time that you do it. So, burpee, one more time, right here. Fast motion, if you need an easier one. Squat thrust. All right, back to 1 minute of cardio. And I have thrusters on here. So that means you're going to squat down. Yep, squat down. And bring the hands up. Squat down, push the hands up. So you can do this here. Jump, jump. Now, if that's too much, just squat down and jump up. Okay, we have nothing in our hands, but we're pushing our hands up to the ceiling. So we're squatting down, pushing up. Squat down, push up. And if you need more, just get faster with it. You don't even have to jump up off the ground. Just as long as you're squatting down and pushing up to the ceiling. That's called a thruster. So hopefully you learned a new exercise for today. All right. Oh, we got 10 more seconds. Oh, now this one is wearing me out. You can move around any way you want with this exercise routine. That was 1 minute. Okay, now we have plank-ups. Now, for plank-ups, there's a couple of different ways you can do them. If you can, hold yourself in a plank here on your hands. Make sure your butt is not up in the air or your belly's not sagging down. Plank-ups, you're gonna go down on your elbows, push yourself back up. Now, if that's too hard, you can get on your elbows and push yourself up and down, up and down. All right, if that's too hard, drop to your knees and do your plank-ups here. You can do them on your hands. Try and tuck your butt under a little so that your arms and your abs feel like they're working. Down, up, all right? But this is for my advanced people here. Down to the elbows, up to the arms. Okay, that is plank-ups. Remember, 5, 10, 15, 20, whatever you need for yourself. Now, we're back to our cardio for 1 minute, and we are gonna do toe touches. Down and touch your toes, up. Down and touch your toes, up. So that's it. But if you want to feel your heart rate going up while you're doing this exercise, it's gonna be down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. Notice I'm going in a circle. I'm having fun with it. I'm moving around. Woo! Yes, that's it. You're doing awesome. I'm so proud of you for exercising. It's the best thing you can do for your body during this time. And we're almost there. Oh, 10 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Whew. All right, that one wasn't as much cardio as the rest, but you can make it harder by jumping up in the air. So now we have handstand push-ups. So this is my version of the handstand push-ups. All right, you're going to put your hands down on the ground. You're going to turn them in towards each other. And you are going to push your head towards the ground. Almost touch the ground and push yourself back up. So right here, you want to touch your head to the ground and push up. This is a handstand push-up. This is an easier version of a handstand push-up. Okay? Now, if that's too hard, just come to your knees. Keep your fingertips facing each other. It's not like the push-up where your fingertips are facing forward. They're facing in towards each other, and you're pushing your head to the ground instead of your chest. All right? So that's the easier version. And this is the harder version. And if you need more, you can do it like in a push-up position. But I'm sure most of us need to work our way up to that. So for now, you do the best you can on those handstand push-ups. Oh, now we're back to cardio. And guess what? We have jog in place. So we have an easier one. And let's get this timer set. I don't know what's going on with my timer. There we go, 1 minute. Okay, we're gonna jog in place. Perfect time for me to tell you about these exercises. This is about the halfway point if you're following along and doing all 10. You know what? If you've had enough for today and you're like, oh, this has just been too much, you made it to the halfway point, so you can go ahead and take a break. And tomorrow, you can try it again and add on one exercise. So if you need to stop halfway, by all means, this is your workout. You do what works for you, not what works for me, not what works for your mom or your dad or your sister or your brother. You're working on you. Focus on you during this time. You can always make something positive out of a negative situation. Or there's always something good in everything and everyone. Woo, there's that 1 minute timer. All right, so for those of you that are going on with me, we are doing lunges for exercise number 6. So you can do lunge out and in, out and in. If you want to do them walking, you can do walking lunges, okay? Now, you do whatever works for you. Now, if you want, you can do a forward lunge and a backwards lunge. Now, the secret with the lunges is you want to make sure that you're bringing the leg out far enough where the knee is going, staying behind the toe. It's not going over the toe, so it's behind the toe. Notice I'm down and my knee is not over my toe. Back up, down, up, down, up. Now, this would be improper. Okay, so the secret is to make sure that you do a big enough step where your knees are both at 90. So the back leg, 90 degrees, front leg at 90 degrees. Now remember, you've got to do lunges. You should do five on each leg. So you don't want to do all five just on one leg. Make sure you do the same amount on the left leg as you do on the right. All right, we're back to our cardio. One of my favorites here, windmills. All right, now, if you need to make these harder, since they are easy and you probably feel your heart rate coming down, you can hop up while you do windmills. So jump, windmill, jump, windmill, jump, windmill, jump, windmill. Woo! How we feeling? I know y'all working hard, because believe me, Coach Gonzalez is getting tired, but I love it. This is when you want to work your hardest. When you're getting tired and your body says, I gotta stop. I don't want to go anymore. When you push through, that is what makes you stronger. That's what makes you better than you were the last time you did the routine. Okay, we're almost there. We're gonna do regular windmills right here. So, remember, this is your workout. You do what works for you. Woo, that was 1 minute. Awesome. Fantastic, I'm so proud of y'all. Okay, we are doing scissor kicks. We're working those abs, and we get to lay down. Woo, who's happy to be laying down right now? Okay, scissor kicks. Spread your arms out, and you want to kick your feet. Now, since it's 5, 10, 15, or 20, you can count how many times your leg scissors. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You can always just estimate this. So if you need more, you just keep going. This is working on the abs. If that's too hard, bring your legs up higher, okay? The lower your legs are and the less distance from the ground, the harder this exercise is. This is called the scissor kicks. All right, so that one, you are probably gonna end up doing a lot more than five. And that's okay, so count each time the right leg goes up in the air. That would be your fifth rep. Repetitions, awesome word for you to write down today if you're taking track, if you're keeping track of new words that you're learning in these exercise routines. Repetition is how many times you repeat the same exercise. All right, so now we are doing our running man. Woo! All right, let me set that timer for 1 minute. Okay, 1 minute, and this is the running man. This is another exercise where you can go around in a circle, have fun with it. Oh, you can go forward, you can go back. You can do whatever you want to do with your 1 minute here. Okay, now I also meant to tell you that you should drink lots of water after you exercise. So make sure your body stays hydrated. Now, if you're getting tired, you can always stop and go get a sip of water and come back. Your body needs water. It doesn't need soft drinks. It needs water when it's exercising. Okay, how we doing? Woo, I know y'all feeling great. I'm so proud of you. So happy you're here with me today. We're almost there. There it is. 1 minute cardio. tricep press. So when you burpee, you're gonna do a tricep press. Triceps are the back of the arms. So when you come up from your burpee, you're going to push your arms back. As you progress with this, you'll find that you need to add some weight into those arms. But for today, we're doing exercises without weights. This is all body weight. You don't need anything for this exercise routine except you. That's it, just you. Well, you might need me to demonstrate, but well, you won't even need me the next time you do it, because you can do this all by yourself. Okay, so here's the burpee tricep press. You're gonna do the burpee, as I showed you before. When you come up, you're gonna push back. So, burpee to the ground, come up and push back instead of putting your hands up over your head. Now, if you need to make it easier, you're going to do that squat thrust. Squat thrust, that's as it is called in PE classes. Okay, you're gonna squat down, thrust your body out, thrust your feet back in under your body, stand up and tricep push. This is the tricep push. So you're doing a burpee or a thruster with a tricep push instead of jumping up over your head. All right, so that is called the burpee tricep press. Oh, I'm so happy all y'all are here. We only have two more cardio exercises and two more exercises behind me. We are getting it today. Okay, high knees for 1 minute. Let's set that timer again. 1 minute of high knees. Now, this is another one where you can work as hard as you want to work. So this is keeping it low, just where your body is moving. Okay, you can go diagonally from one side to the other. You can go forward. So high knees means you're getting those knees up towards your chest. Okay, if you need to keep it with that jump out of it, you can still bring your knees up without a jump. You can bring it low. Okay, if you have to do low knees, that is absolutely fine. Do low knees. Work your way up to those high knees. Okay? Here we go. We are moving along. You can go in a circle. You can go forward. You can go back. Have fun with it. Woohoo! I get so excited. That was 1 minute. Awesome. Now, we have inchworms. That's our last exercise here on the board. And we have one more cardio exercise. And then you want to finish every exercise routine with a little bit of a stretch and cool down. Oh, excuse me. I made a mistake. We have two more exercises up there. I said one, but we got this. We've got this. We're in this together. We're in this exercise routine together, and we're gonna finish it together. All right, triangle push-ups. Woo, that sounds fun. So, you put your hands in a triangle, and then you come back to your same push-up position that we did earlier. You want to make sure that your hands are right underneath your shoulders. You come up on your toes, your feet are spread about hip-width apart, and then you're gonna bring your chest to the ground, and up. Now, if that's too hard, you drop to your knees, and same thing. You keep those hands in a triangle position, and if you have to, you come to all fours, and you still down, up. That's called the triangle push-up. Now, this is probably very advanced, and this is for my advanced people. Now, this is for the intermediate people. On your knees, triangle. Okay, and if that, my beginner people, you may want to start here. Because you have to work your chest for it to get stronger. As it gets stronger, you can do more of these exercises or more complicated versions of the exercises. All right, so we have our last 1 minute of cardio, which is the shuffle. So we're gonna get low, working those quads, and we're gonna shuffle from side to side. Okay, you want to get fancy with it, touch the ground. You want to, it's like you're moving right foot, bringing the left one to meet it. Right foot, left one meets it. Right foot, left meets it. When you go in the opposite direction, left foot moves, right foot comes to meet it. You want to keep your hands by your side here. You're going to put the elbows against your rib cage. Shuffle. I'm sure some of you have seen the football players doing it. Now you're doing just what the football players do. This exercise routine can be hard, it can be easy, it can be whatever you want it to be. If this is too easy for you, just do more of it or do it longer. Okay, now for those of you that can do it real fast, go real fast for 1 minute. There's that timer. Oh, I love it when I'm working hard and I feel that timer and I'm like, I did it for a minute. Woo! Okay, inchworms. Now, here we go with those push-ups again. But guess what? By the time you're done with this, you're going to be able to do push-ups all day long. Okay, inchworm. So, you want to stay with your hands by your side. You're going to bend down, put your hands out on the ground, walk yourself out. Then you're going to push your chest to the ground, and then you're going to push yourself back up and lock your hands back in. Now, that's the advanced version. The intermediate version is you're just going to bend down, put your hands on the ground, walk your hands out, and lock your hands back in. Now, if that's still too hard and you need the beginner version, just bend your knees, put your hands on the ground, go out as far as you can, and come back. You do your inchworm. My inchworm might look different than your inchworm, but everybody's doing the inchworm, and that's all that matters. So, advanced inchworms with that push-up in it. That intermediate inchworm is, well, you can bend your knees if you have to. You're just going to walk the hands out as far as you can and bring them back. And the beginner version, bend the knees, walk your hands out, and walk them back. So kiddos, I am proud of you today. I am Coach Gonzalez from St. Tammany Parish Schools, and I am so glad that you were here to do these exercises with me today. So I hope that you enjoy doing them on your own, and maybe one day when all this is over, you can teach this exercise routine to someone else. So for now, toodaloos, bye kids.
Hi, my name is Regina Morgavio, and I'm a mental health provider with the St. Tammany Parish School Board. I wanted to talk to you today about the importance of self-care. I talk to my students a lot about self-care and explain to them the need to take care of themselves and to do things they enjoy doing. There's a lot of uncertainty in the world right now and a lot of things that are outside of our control, but you can control how you take care of yourself. Maybe you're already using a regular self-care routine, but maybe you're not. This could be a great opportunity for you to incorporate some new self-care techniques in your regular routine. Self-care could really be anything that you enjoy doing and that brings you happiness. A lot of my students really enjoy listening to music, drawing, painting, reading books, and talking with friends. But self-care could be other things, such as playing a family game, going on a daily walk, doing some stretching or yoga. As long as you're doing something to bring you some happiness during this time. I hope this video has been helpful and you're able to find something that you can use on a regular basis for self-care. Thanks.